Hey guys, my name is Jason with Mount Baker Mining and Metals, and today we're going to be reprocessing some of my old Portland cement cupels that we've used in the past for refining some of our gold and silver beads. And as you can see, we've got the lead oxide locked up in the Portland cement, so we're going to try and reduce the lead oxide back to lead metal by smelting them, and then if I can get the lead metal out, I'm going to try and re-cupel them and see if we lost any gold and silver in the process.
Here's a little bit closer look at these things, and it's the lead oxide that's been absorbed into the Portland cement and has crystallized essentially. And so, whoops, there we go. And so what I'm going to try and do is by using charcoal and borax, try and reduce the lead oxide back to lead metal and have it all collect down in the bottom of our cone mold. So first step is I'm going to get these kind of crushed up, and then we'll take a look at our flux and our charcoal, and we'll get it all mixed in a crucible and get it fired up and see if we can get it reduced back to metallic lead. I got our stuff kind of crushed up just using a mortar and pestle into small sizes, but I want to get it a little bit finer so we can get a lot of good interaction between the charcoal and the borax with the oxides. And I've had this thing forever. This is a really old Biko pulverizer, and it's been used for, you know, years and years, this style, in assay labs. And how this thing works is it's got a shaft back here that's driven off a pulley off a motor, and this plate here turns, and this plate is stationary. You feed the material down in the center here. It comes through the middle of this stationary plate. And as this turns, it's got to come through this little tiny gap here. And so it does a really good job of fine crushing for small samples. And then to clean it, you undo these. The front folds down and you can clean it out, blow it out, whatever. But I was going to kind of resurrect this thing and crush our sample down into this tub here I got. And I'm going to be sure to wear a respirator. This lead oxide is nothing to get too cavalier with. So let's get this thing fired up and see if I can crush this stuff. Well, that was kind of a pain, actually. Mental note for everyone, if you end up running one of these little pulverizers, make sure it's screened to about half inch, because when it gets stuck in that funnel, it's really a bugger to get out. But anyway, it did a great job. It pulverized it up pretty good. So now we have lots of surface area that we can get our chemical reactions going. And then I opened up the machine here so you can see how it works. This plate, the material comes in the front. Oh, here, let me get it. So there's how we saw it earlier. So you just undo these. It folds down in front, and then the material comes in. The plates are textured here. This one spins, and as they rub against each other, the material has to grind enough to where it comes out this the gap between the plates, and it just falls out the bottom. So that's what we got. We'll get this prepared and get ready for smelting. All right, I got our stuff weighed, and it weighs just about 3,500 grams, so that's right about 7.5 pounds for all us Americans. But my old books say that if you're going to use flour as a reducer, it takes about 1 gram of flour to reduce 19 grams of lead, and if you're using charcoal, it takes about 1 gram of charcoal to reduce 30 grams of lead. So if we assume that the total weight of this is lead, we're going to need a little over 100 grams of charcoal. for our carbon. So I'm going to, I'll get some crushed up and weighed and we'll take a look, but I'm going to shoot for 150 to 200 grams. I figure it's better to have more carbon than less. It's not going to hurt anything. And then we'll talk about borax for our flux in a minute. And here's for our carbon. I'm just going to use good old charcoal briquettes. So I'll get these crushed up and actually I'll probably run them through the pulverizer and powder them so I can get a good mix all through, through our material here in the crucible. So let me crush these up, get them powdered, and I'll show you what I get. Okay, so I got our charcoal ground up. I have a little over 200 grams here, so we should have plenty of carbon to reduce our lead. And then, so I'll get these two mixed up. I'm not really sure what's going to happen here. Almost all the weight here is in lead, which shouldn't have very much volume once it's reduced. And then all we got to do with the borax is just soak up the rock, the cement part. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix these together, see how much I got and how much volume I need in for my crucible, and then we'll mix some borax in there, and I'll probably end up having to do two smelts here to get all of our lead out. But we'll get it mixed up and take a look. So here's the borax I'm going to use, and this is anhydrous borax, so there's no water in this. If you go to your grocery store and you buy borax, probably what you're going to end up getting is the borax, I think it's pentahydrate. I think there's five water molecules attached to each borax molecule. And in that case, you're just buying a bunch of water weight, which is okay. It still does the same thing. But when you smelt, you have to drive off all that water before you end up with the borax chemical that you want. So I buy it as anhydrous borax. It's a little bit more expensive, but I think this is like a 55-pound bag, and it was like $20 or $50 or something. So it's not very expensive. And it really helps when you're smelting because you end up with the borax anhydrous, which doesn't have any water in it, which is what you want. So I have 700 grams of borax here about, and there's my stuff. I'm really taking a flyer here. I'm just going to mix this all together. And then as I need more borax, if I do during the smelt, I can always add it on top in the furnace as it's going. So I can kind of check the consistency with the stir rod, but I'll get all this mixed up and we'll see what we got, and we'll get a smelt going, and then we'll kind of work from there. Here's the furnace we're going to be using. It's just a Rapakao wool. That's a number 12 fire clay crucible. And I just made this furnace this morning, actually. I just took another video of it. So I'll post a link here in the video to a video showing how to make this furnace. But this is what we're going to be using. It's got the propane going in there. Here's our stuff all shook up. So I'm going to pour that material in here until it's probably about 3/4 of the way up the side of the crucible. And then we'll get it fired up. I got a good 2/3 in there. There's a little bit that's left. So we'll probably have to do two smelts here. But there it is. We'll get it fired up, and I'll show you how we get the lead out. I just got to thinking about it, and I added, I don't know if you can see down in there, but I added a cap of borax because we really want that carbon to not react with any oxygen in the air, and so I put that borax on top to keep the oxygen out and let the carbon react with the lead oxide. And while I'm up here, I'll give you a little tour. We got the propane injector here. The black hose goes to the propane bottle. The blue hose goes down to that valve where I can control the airflow. And that's just a cheap shop vac from Home Depot or something, set to blow instead of suck. And I'm using it for a blower to force oxygen in and improve our combustion.
So in this shot, you can actually see those little silver beads floating on top. Those are actually molten lead beads, and you can watch them as they kind of get together and get bigger. They roll off that iceberg of material floating in the crucible, and they sink down to the bottom. So all those little shiny beads you're seeing are actually molten lead that's been reduced by the charcoal and is rolling down to the bottom, forming our lead puddle at the bottom of the crucible.
So this is a shot you guys all like to see, is that cooling slag on top, and it's just starting to form a skin. And there it goes. So a little more material than the cone mold could handle. That's why I put it in that steel bin there. And we still have a little bit more to smelt, so I'll get that going here. And we can get our two lead buttons and get them weighed and see how much lead we recovered. The other thing about when you're using lead, either as a collector metal or you're reprocessing like we're doing here, is the lead has a really low melting point. So that cone mold needs to cool way, way, way down before we end up knocking it out of there. Because if you don't let it cool down below the melting point of lead, which I have done before, you end up turning it over, the slag's all cold and, well, solid, and then you get molten lead splashing all over the place. So we'll let that cool way down before we end up knocking it out. So there you go. Sometimes it takes a little bit of convincing to get the metal block out. Especially, I haven't done a smelt in this mold in several months, so it's probably a little rusty, and the first one always sticks a little bit. But on the second pour, we'll see if it'll just knock out of there. But there's our lead. There's our first lead cone. And that's actually quite a bit of lead. There's a lot of weight there. You can see our slag is all pretty glassy. It poured really fluid. So we'll get the other one poured, get them all cooled down, and then we'll get a weight on them. All right, here's our second one. It's cooled down quite a bit. Let's see if I can get it out of there this time. No, it's stubborn too. Let me get it knocked out with a hammer and we'll take a look. So I got it knocked out. It wasn't too bad. And we got another lead block here. So we'll get it up there and get them weighed. So there's our two lead blocks we got. And turns out we recovered almost exactly 3 pounds, or about 1,350 grams. And so about, I think it's about half, a little less than half of the weight was lead that we recovered. So that's pretty cool. And so here tomorrow, I'll get another video. We're going to take these lead blocks, and we're going to re-cupel them in some real bone ash cupels and see if we can recover any more precious metals that we may have lost in Portland cement. There, when I was cupelling them the first time, it ended up with little cracks and stuff in the cement, and I think I may have lost some. So I just want to reprocess them to see if we can recover any more gold. So stay tuned for that video. I'll post a link to it at the end of this one. And if you have any questions or comments, please let us know. You can find our contact info in the description below. So thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.